With so much confusion going on in the world, so many voices, you have to go on a journey and isolate yourself in order to know what you really think.
Wait, what? Welcome, welcome. Happy 2023, right? Right? Listen. It's a new year, and as you can see, we have a new set, so we have a lot to talk about. And as always, I'm joined by a beautiful and amazing live studio audience. Please give yourselves a round of applause. I got a question for you. Do you guys usually make resolutions?
Yes.
Yeah? Did anybody make one this year so far? Uh-huh. You know, I read recently an article in Forbes, and it says that 80% of the people abandon their resolutions by February. So that's not long into the new year, which means that we're typically caught up in a frenzy. We're typically moving with a feeling, and that's kind of what we're going to talk about today, is these things that don't really mean things, but unfortunately have a staple in our society today. What do I mean? Well, in the last episode last year, I made a comment in which I said, cancel culture is of the devil. And we got a lot of feedback about that. So today, we're gonna talk about cancel culture. What does it mean? What is cancel culture as a Christian? Should we be participating in cancel culture? My fundamental problem is this: how can we let someone tell us how to feel, what to think, and what to say? How can we say the things that we can't say? What do I mean? Well, in this country, we have fought for freedom of speech. But it seems today that there is not freedom of speech. It's freedom to speak privately as long as you're not heard. But when you decide to speak publicly on a thing, you're open and susceptible for whatever attack that someone wants to have on you. That is of the devil. It's a war on fundamentals. It is not the culture that Christ has set for us to partake in. And why is this important? Well, it's important because as believers, we have to be able to identify when someone is trying to silence us, when someone is trying to get us to go with something that we don't truly believe, and someone, or I should say, an entity, a society, is really trying to force or mandate us to do things that our beliefs just won't allow us. So we're gonna talk about a lot. We have an amazing year ahead of us. Are you guys excited about your year? You guys excited? Actually, cancel culture is not even really that new of a concept. It's actually a residue of things that we've seen throughout our history. For instance, if you think back to the 1960s civil rights era, right? Boycotting was a sense of cancel culture because of marginalized people being treated unfairly or unjustly, they decided that we're not going to give you your services, we're not going to take part in your transportation or your business, and therefore it sent a message. But cancel culture now has become less about treating the unjust fairly or justly, and it's become more about treating them unjustly, more about group shaming. It's like now they want to make sure, when I say they, let's clear this air. The societal norm is the they I'm talking about. They want to make you okay with things that you really don't buy into. And this is just extra, extra, extra important as believers that we start to take self-inventory and we start to acknowledge, call these things out. Let us cancel culture, right? I think it's time that we cancel culture. So again, great show. I have an amazing guest for you today. She is going to give us so many different aspects about what it is that we are going to, how we're going to be affected or how people are affected, as well as what we can do to make sure that we're not prisoners of a culture that is not ours. Keep in mind, cancel culture is a war on our fundamentals. And we have to protect our fundamentals at all costs. So with that being said, we'll be right back and we're gonna have a little time to see what the Bible says about cancel culture. In case you didn't think that the Bible talks about it, I'm gonna show you a little bit where it does. All right, let's talk about it, right? I will see you.
God's doing a new thing, yeah. Get ready for overflow, 'cause I'm getting ready.
Guys, all right, we're back. Hopefully you enjoyed that that first segment. Yeah, you enjoyed the first segment. I did too. It feels good to be in the new year, you know. That's why it is very, very important that we don't go into a new year with an old mindset.
That's good.
I think what was the most disheartening about like these previous few years is, you know, we actually saw a divide. Like, but the divisions have always been there. But this one was kind of scary. Mm. Because it seems like now the divide will actually try to affect your livelihood. It'll try to affect your communities. You know, I remember, you know, churches not being able to worship. And you know, all of this is really a precursor to end times.
True.
It really is.
Yep.
You know, it's important that we understand the residue of, or at least the remnants of things before they happen. You know, as I was preparing for this show, I asked the Lord, well, Father, you know, I like to sit at this desk and I like to speak the word of God because, you know, what's the point of my opinion on things? And I said, well, what do you want me to speak about? You know, and he gave me quite the morsel that I'm going to share with you. But first, I want to also talk about how the body of Christ should be the exception and not the rule to cancel culture.
Talk about it.
Who here is familiar with Hillsong?
Yep.
Hillsong.
Yep.
To be honest, I came to know about Hillsong as a worship group. And from there, all over the world is like they're leading people to Christ. But not too long ago, their pastor had a little issue. And from there, he was kicked out of the church. Mm. Now, I don't know the current state of it to date. Preferably, I hope that people are resolving their issues. And I hope that people really know how to allow the relationship with God, the one-on-one with God, to really be the end-all, be-all, mm-hmm. and not their judgment. But the thought was this. What he did was wrong. Especially in the public eye and in the position that he holds. Mm. But now I want to pose a question. Should the church take part in cancel culture? Now, I know some of you may think, well, there's morals, there's bylaws, there's things that must be upheld. Well, what about what Christ would uphold?
That part.
I want to paint a picture. You have a man of God who's helping to save souls all over the world. From celebrities, those who feel some kind of way about Christ or Christianity. And all are being drawn in. And then you have a man of God who falls. Now we know what the Bible says. Mm-hmm. It says a righteous man falls 7 times and get up 8. So why would then the church decide, you know what? You fell, but we're going to deny that 8th. When does the church take on that right and responsibility to deny that 8th?
Talk about it.
So back to this picture, saving people all over the world. And then he has his mistake, just a mistake, and he's kicked out. Now I ask you a question. Which is better? Which is more Christ-like? To see a mistake and to ostracize, to abandon, to forsake, or to see a mistake, bring him in, wash him clean, make him whole, and
there
then put him back out before people saying, this is our man of God.
That's it.
The church, unfortunately, is losing its sight of its weight in the world.
Wow.
And it's time that we revisit how God, through his son Jesus, wants us to respond to the weight of the world. So I want us to pull up in our Bible. Let's go to Matthew 8:3.
Amen. Matthew chapter 8, verse number 3. And Jesus put forth his hand and touched him, saying, I will, be thou clean. And immediately his leprosy was cleansed.
So in ancient times, there was this one little old disease called leprosy. And society had already all but decided that leprosy is the unclean. It represents sin. And it did. Mm. It definitely did, by the law of Moses, represent sin. Mm. So now we're in a new time. And society is still of that same old thinking. And anyone with leprosy was considered an outcast. Don't touch them. Don't interact with them. Don't look at them, et cetera, et cetera. But read it again, Matthew 8.
Verse 3.
Mm-hmm.
And Jesus put forth his hand and touched him, saying, I will, be thou clean. And immediately his leprosy was cleansed.
So Jesus reached forth his hand and touched him. He reached out and touched people who at that time was considered the lowest of society, who faced rejection, who was oftentimes just perceived as beggars along the road. So much so that even the rabbis of that time would not be seen near them. They would not even interact with them. But as the man of God here just says, and Jesus stretched forth his hand and touched him. That touch. Can y'all say that touch?
That touch.
That touch sent forth ripples in time.
Wow.
That touch.
That's deep.
Caused the whole establishment to turn upside down.
That's deep.
That touch from God is what this world is missing today.
Amen.
We need that touch again.
Absolutely.
We have forgotten that touch. It states, as you read scripture, that the rabbis, the high officials, were the ones that were like, nope, not going to do it. But Jesus, a king who came as a servant, who lowered his position in the eyes of man.
Wow.
But yet the king of all kings said, I will touch you. I will touch you. I will heal you. Now, some may think, oh, well, that was good that one time. And that was just how he was. It was the kindness of his heart. But we've seen several times over. We know the story where he healed the 10 and the one came back. So it wasn't just a one-off. But I want to turn into scripture and I want to read another passage. Let's go to Matthew. I believe it's Matthew.
Chapter 10.
Chapter 10. What was the verse I gave you?
Verse 8.
Matthew chapter 10, verse 8. Yes.
Amen. Heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, cast out devils. Freely ye have received, freely give. That's deep.
Wait a minute.
Yeesh.
Could you read that just again for those who weren't listening that first time?
Yep. Matthew chapter 10, verse 8. Heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, cast out devils. Freely ye have received, freely give.
My fellow brothers and sisters, Christ never intended us to be set apart from people in cancel culture way. We're supposed to be set apart, but we're supposed to take everything, every societal norm, and we're supposed to be the answer, the exception. We're supposed to be able to impact it. As it states there in the scripture, we're supposed to heal the leprosy on top of all those other things. See, the issue is this. We want to do the other things, but we also are very selective in what those things are.
That's true. That's so true.
The body of Christ has become very selective in what fight we want to take on. We want to fight our brothers, our sisters. We want to fight within the four walls, but we don't want to offend those outside. But those outside don't mind offending you. Those outside don't mind telling you what they believe. Those outside don't, people don't mind telling you what they're going to do. But oftentimes we are the mute. We are the quiet. That's not what he means when he says be the meek. The meek shall inherit.
That's it.
So as this body of Christ, how do we even approach cancel culture?
Help us.
I promise you, if you're watching now, you're like, didn't he say this last time? This show is not about cancel culture. What it is, in its own way, it's going to be about canceling the cancel culture.
Deep.
It's going to be about challenging the cancel culture. I love every single person on this planet. The Lord does too. It's what the word says. For God so loved the world. But we've allowed division or divisiveness in so many forms. And this one is just another form. But unfortunately, this one is really not set up for us to win anything. Because if you start saying yes now to things you don't want to do, things you don't believe, you give your yes, you're going to have to keep giving your yes. That's true. You know, I remember seeing what happened to various musicians, celebrities, and I remember thinking, who gives another person the right to say, this is how you should live? This is what you should be doing. We have to be mindful of this. You know, there was a, saying, but it's true. If you put the red ants in a jar with the black ants, they will exist just fine with each other. But if you shake that jar, they will begin to fight and they will begin to cancel each other.
Wow. That's sheesh.
Do you guys know who's doing the shaking in your life?
Wow.
Are you even paying attention to the fact that the jar is being shaken? This world is being shaken right now. And I always say, you know, us here in this Western world, we really don't know persecution. Not yet.
Yeah, that's true.
Not yet.
That's true.
Persecution to a lot of believers today is, I can't pay my rent. I don't know what to do. I can't pay this bill. I can't pay this card note. They fired me. That's small in comparison.
So small.
So we're about equipping you. And the goal is we're going to equip you.
Amen.
I have a guest coming up. She's a doctor. I'm going to introduce her on the next segment, but she's also a mental health therapist. She's someone that is going to help us understand the effects, the societal effects of cancel culture. And the goal is for us to take this information and to talk. And to understand what we need to do going forward as the body of Christ. So we'll be right back with the amazing, the incomparable Dr. O. All right, we'll see you in a minute.
Amen.
Welcome back. We missed you. We missed you. We missed you. We missed you. So, you know, typically when people want to correct something about you, it's because there's something about you that they disagree with. And that's not always bad. But what about when the agenda towards you is not good? See, that's when you need to examine what it is and why they want to correct you. You know, cancel culture, we know, hasn't been a new thing. They tried to cancel Christ, right?
Right.
And they failed, right?
Right.
Hallelujah, right?
Hallelujah.
All right. So you won't be alone with any type of persecution, but you also won't be in a place in which you won't need to recognize how you need to stand and the best way to stand. Cancel culture removes enlightened discussions. So today, I have brought someone that's going to give us some enlightened discussion. So with us today, we have my personal doctor and friend of the show, Dr. Okafor. Please give her a hand.
Thank you.
So Dr. Okafor, please tell us a little bit about yourself. I know you got a lot of titles, so if I mess one up earlier, please give the people an opportunity to know the real ones.
First of all, thank you so much for having me on. This is an amazing platform, especially to the prophet of the house, Prophet Lovy, that we love so much.
Yes.
So I thank you, JT, for allowing me to be here. So Dr. Okafor, most people call me Dr. O. I am a psychiatric and family practice doctor. I'm also big in fitness, and I have my own practice called the Perfect Prescription Medical Services PC, where we service from 5 years old all the way up to geriatrics age, and we do all diagnosis, but we also are a wellness clinic, so we're also doing IV hydration and fitness plans as well, and we just do a combination of things, hormone replacement as well, to service people individualized treatment plans.
Oh, that's cool. That's cool. So, thank you once again for coming.
Absolutely.
I know the topic is not something that you are too foreign to. Now, I wanted to ask you some questions that are specific to your field.
Okay.
One of the first questions being, how do you think cancel culture was created, and that how it got so big, or when was it created, and how did it get to this point where it is today?
Yeah, that's a deep question. It's a two-part question. You said something earlier about Jesus Christ, so we know we can go all the way back. That was the first time cancel culture was even created.
True.
But when I think about that question, I think about how many people had to read the Scarlet Letter. Do anybody remember that? Right?
Yeah, the Scarlet Letter.
We were forced to read that book. A lot of people did not read it. They read the Spark Notes.
Yeah, yeah.
But I actually read the book.
Guilty.
So in this book, it's a young lady named Hester Prynne. I believe that was her last name. So this young lady had an affair with the minister, right? When she had this affair, she got pregnant. So in this, what we would say culture, this community, they shunned her. They put her out. She had to become isolated because it was against their social norm. So I believe when I hear cancel culture, I think about that time.
Mm-hmm.
And this was back in the 1600s when this thing happened. So I believe it replicates of what's happening now. So with that same thing, I believe cancel culture is a set of people with similar beliefs that decides to cancel. And when I even hear the word cancel, I think about TV shows. This show is canceled.
That's true.
Right?
That's true.
This show cannot be replayed. It's over. It's done. So it's a set of people with these beliefs that decides, I'm going to take this control to cancel you because I don't believe in what you believe in, or something you have done or something that you have said goes against my social norm.
Oh, wow.
Right?
That's good.
And then the second part of that question of how did it get so big?
Yeah.
So we know that it's gone all the way back to Jesus' time. And in a culture, it's a set of beliefs that comes from generation to generation to generation. So it's nothing new. But now we live in a society where there's social media. So now everything is fast.
That's good.
It's quickened. So one person can go on there if they have a small platform. They speak on it. Somebody catches it. Then they now spread it.
Mm-hmm.
Now they repost, and it gets bigger and bigger and bigger and faster and faster. And so I think that's how it has grew its own head compared to back in the day.
So that's very good, actually. The social media effect, I will concur and say that's like a doctor thing, huh? I concur, right? I concur. But that is probably single-handedly how it spreads so fast today.
So fast.
I find that oftentimes people are just trying to group think their way through life.
That's good.
And more people, and I know I said this before, but this is my underlying belief, Boldness is so key as a believer. If your boldness is trapped, if your boldness is locked, if your boldness is tucked away, you are flowing in the way society wants you to flow.
Come on.
You're not flowing in the way that God wants you to go. Now, I want to ask you again, you deal with mental health patients and issues, correct?
Yes.
What are the psychological effects of cancel culture?
I think that's also a two-part question, because we think when someone's being canceled, we only focus on the person that's being canceled. But no one ever sits back and think about the actual culture in itself, like the people that are canceling. Okay. So I believe that this culture is bypassing empathy and forgiveness for in favor of righteous anger.
That's good. That's good.
And so even when you're breaking down righteous anger, what is righteous? Being that self-righteousness, right? Self-righteousness goes to pride. Where does pride come from? That comes from rebellion. Where does rebellion come from? That comes from rejection. So now you are doing this because you have been rejected somewhere in life. So now you're you're projecting your rejection onto everyone else, right? So now we're looking at this side. Okay, now what you've done goes against me. I've taken it personal, what you've done. For instance, I think about Kevin Hart.
Okay,
I don't know if you remember that time. Kevin Hart had an affair, and this was private, but it was leaked out to everybody, right?
I remember.
And so how do we know what happened behind closed doors in the sense of him apologizing to his wife, apologizing to his children, and they say, I forgive you for what you've done, right?
Yeah.
But then we, or this culture says, no, that's not enough. I want you to be humiliated. I want you to be shamed in front of everybody because you have this persona or you have this platform of power. No, I'm going to take it into my hands. Although your family has forgiven you,
I don't.
So now when you're thinking about the psychological aspect of it, you're thinking about this person. Why did you take it so personal? Did something happen down in your line where this thing that this person has done has affected you?
That's
right.
Good. That's good.
And so now you think about the other side. This person has been rejected. So guess what I'm going to do? I'm going to make you feel rejected too. Right? So then it's like the whole saying, hurt people.
Hurt people.
Right?
Right, right.
So now I'm going to hurt you because I want you to feel despair. And I want that to lead into a depression, into anxiety. It's like public jail, right? With being a cruel and unusual punishment. I want you to feel a certain way where I'm hurt and I want you to feel that hurt too. Although everybody in your life has apologized and moved on, no, it's not enough for me. So I think that's the part that's playing on the mind of, I don't care if you go into a depression, into anxiety, to suicidal thoughts, you deserve this. Who are you to say that?
I'm sorry, for those of you listening right now, please drop a fire in the comments. If you think this is fire, please drop your fire in the comments. You know, as you were speaking, the scripture Colossians 3 and 13 came and it said, forbearing one another and forgiving one another, if any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, so also do ye. You had said that you believe that cancel culture causes the bypassing of empathy and forgiveness.
Yes.
And we see here that God is always telling us to forgive one another. And so I want to ask you this then. If we forgive and society is still society, what is it? You know, people going people. You know, people-peopling. How can we condemn actions without feeling as though cancellation is necessary? So let me ask it even better. How can people, and you're helping the people, how can people see things? Maybe you are actually someone who's a part of cancel culture. Maybe you're the one that has a small voice. Maybe you're in a boardroom. And maybe you're in a group of people right now and you don't feel like you can say certain things that you want to say. Help those people understand, how can you see something that you don't like, disagree with it, but not shun people?
So I believe that everything deals with communication, right? Because that question was deep. Because I'm thinking about it like this, right? if we were to move in a way where all our actions has to depend on if this person is going to like it, then I honestly should be canceled. Mm-hmm. You should be canceled. Mm-hmm. You should be canceled. You should be canceled, and you should be canceled because something I'm doing, you're not liking, right? Mm-hmm. So it's a communication thing. Now, scripture-wise, when Paul talks about if my brother doesn't like mm-hmm. when I eat meat, mm-hmm. then I shouldn't do it.
Yeah,
that's
yeah.
a communication yeah. thing. Hey, what you did, I just didn't care
it's
for it.
That's
it's
good.
A communication. But the thing is with the cancel culture, it's not that they want you to learn anything from it. They want you to hurt. They want pain. They don't want you to learn and grow because it's going back to the whole thing, I should be canceled. Some things that I've done in my past, you're not gonna like, right? But should I be condemned if I've grown from it and learned from it? Should I still think about those times and live in guilt and shame?
Should anyone have the power to drum all that up and then force that on you?
Exactly.
So that's very good. That's very good. We know that what the Word of God says, mm-hmm. and you know, and it says the goodness of God brings men to repentance, right? So if we're out here forgiving people, now let me say this very, very clearly. There are things that just are not a part of what you do, mm-hmm. right? It's not saying go out and everybody, because that's also kind of what's happening is in this all-inclusive society that we're in now, nobody wants to draw lines. Mm. So that's not what we're saying. You have to stand firm on the foundation that God has given you. But what we are saying is, as believers, you also got to be the standard bearer of yeah. what Christ looks like in their life. Mm-hmm. If someone comes to you that has a heavy burden, or as it says, heavy laden, you know, leading them to Christ is the only true way that burden is going to be lifted. I know you. In your practice, you deal with a lot of patients, mm-hmm. but from what I also learned, you don't shun away the name of Jesus in your practice, do you?
I do not, not at all.
And when did you make that decision that, or that distinction that this is who you were going to be in your practice?
When I learned what true deliverance is, which mm-hmm. is the finished work of the cross. Mm-hmm. And the Lord said that, because this is a conversation that's not talked about where there's mental health and religion. Mm-hmm. That is not something that is normal. Mm-hmm. And so me being a Christian and walking with the Lord in that way, that cannot be separated. That's who I am. Mm-hmm. So you're naturally going to get that light from me. And then through my light and being just like as trying to be like Jesus, mm-hmm. right? And saying like forgiveness and being loving to everybody else. Even if someone came that was an atheist or didn't believe mm-hmm. in God, they can still relate to my light because it's a level of open love. Mm-hmm. I even had a patient, I think he was like 15, mm-hmm. has tried to commit suicide mm-hmm. within 3 months, probably 3 times, right? Mm-hmm. And the parents were like, he never is able to relate to anybody. We have so many therapists, so many psychiatrists, so we hope he'll relate to you. After I had the appointment with him, he said, I really appreciate you. And I was like, wow, he said, and he got teary-eyed. He said, you didn't judge me. You didn't judge me. You just showed love and nobody has ever did that to me. Not even his parents. Mm-hmm. Because I was open-hearted and not throwing Jesus down his throat. I don't know if that's your relationship, but mm-hmm. me and my light and how I'm showing love is an act of God, mm-hmm. right? So in himself, he's now able to open. That's deliverance.
Yeah.
That's the finished work of the cross. That's not condemning you of what you've done. Now, if conviction happens, by all means, let the Lord do what he's going to do. But I'm not going to condemn you of your past when I want you to be better.
No, that's
what
good.
Is that going to do?
That's good. That's good. Drop some fires in the comments. Wow. Was that helpful? You at home?
So.
Is it helpful?
I hope
is
so.
Is it helpful? You know, you said something that may spark another invite. You talked about suicide. I think it's time for the church to really tackle that.
Yes.
So would you come back if I invite you back?
Absolutely.
Would y'all want to see her back? All right.
Absolutely.
Okay. So tell the people where they can find you. Dr. O, who is single.
OMG.
No, on IG, what'd you say? OMG.
OMG. I am on Instagram at Dr. Chi RX. Our practice is also on Instagram at The Perfect RX, and you can go to our website, www.theperfectrx.com. So silly.
There you have it. I think now I just want to take a moment with you guys, and you know, we've covered a lot, and we have a lot more to cover in this coming year. So always drop down in the comments some suggestions, some thoughts, what you want the show to tackle. You know, I've seen already some real fun ones, you know, from anywhere from business to relationships. Oh, yeah, that's a book that, you know, that I have out in that space. So that's going to be a fun one. I've also seen just various things. It's kind of like a long list. As always, you know, to keep these type of things going, please, if you feel it in your heart, support. Go to the website, revelationchurchla.org. As you see fit, give. As you see, we got three amazing shows airing on this platform with Live Yielded, yes, with In Treatment, yes, and also, Let's Talk About It.
Yes.
If you want to stay connected with me, you can find me at jtboy.co, is my website. Also, you can find me on social media. You'll see the links below. And last thing I want to say is this. People have normalized cancel culture. It's affected our society dearly. I think it's time we normalize forgiveness culture.
That's good.
Let's make that a new thing in 2023. Let's make forgiveness culture.
Hashtag.
And we're going to make it a hashtag. We're going to do all that. But right now, type forgiveness culture in the comments, because I want you to even see yourself and associate yourself with it. As always, it is an honor and a pleasure to be on the platform that Dr. Lovy Elias has built. We thank you for your support. And I got to ask a question. Will you be back for the next episode?
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay. So tell your aunties, tell your mama, tell your daddy, tell all your brothers and sisters, tell your nephews and your nieces too. Because they act like we don't know what they're doing nowadays. That it is time to talk. And if it's time to talk, let's talk about it. We'll see you next time.